The man who the cap fits. The true story. A story told like never before. The essential Babangida.
Eventually, sanity prevails. Somebody will say, now, wait a minute. I think there is truth in here. And I think eventually, I do believe the public will.
IBB, the true story. Ikoyi, Lagos, February 13, 1976. A hot, dry day. Loads of artillery and armored vehicles roam the streets. Sounds of sporadic gunfire pervade the atmosphere as renegade soldiers led by Lieutenant Colonel Burkasuka Dinka engage men of the Nigerian army in a gun battle for the control of Radio Nigeria. A few hours before, the head of the Nigerian state, General Muritala Ramat Mohammed, had been assassinated in broad daylight in a bloody coup d'etat on the streets of Lagos. Hundreds of bystanders scurried for cover as millions of Nigerians hid behind the sanctuary of locked doors in the relative safety of their homes. The Nigerian nation was at the edge of a precipice. Rebel soldiers had staged a coup against the seven-month-old regime of the immensely popular General Mohammed. Amid the uncertainty, the staccato sound of military rifles, amid the chaos and the death, the rubble and gunfire, stood the diminutive figure of a young 34-year-old soldier, unarmed. He had embarked on a daunting task to stop the bloodshed and thwart the coup that had taken the life of the head of state. That brave unarmed soldier was Lieutenant Colonel Ibrahim Badamasi Babangida. Babangida had put his life on the line to save the Nigerian nation. With an uncanny power of persuasion, this young armor corps officer repeatedly and single-handedly botched one of the bloodiest coups in the annals of the history of modern Africa. That day, 13 February 1976, brought to national limelight the ever-smiling, enigmatic, gap-toothed diplomat soldier who appeared destined to become arguably Nigeria's most revered statesman, leader, soldier, diplomat, and president. The man, Ibrahim Badamasi Babangida, popularly known by his apt acronym, IBB. The principal beneficiary of IBB's bravery on that hot February day was Lieutenant General Olusegun Obasanjo, who as Chief of Staff Supreme Headquarters was General Muhammad's deputy. Obasanjo, via Dimka's treason and Babangida's bravery, immediately became the new head of state. In his book, My Command, Obasanjo described IBB as the most loyal officer in the Nigerian army. The story of Ibrahim Badamasi Babangida is a story that cannot be told in a hurry. It is a story of doggedness and determination, great intelligence, legendary generosity, kindness, brave and courageous leadership. His story is that of an exemplary and loving husband and father, a leader of men and a loyal friend. The story of Ibrahim Badamasi Babangida is a tale forged by his peculiar experiences. Born in Mina Niger State on August 17, 1941, IBB was orphaned at the age of 14 years. Ibrahim Badamasi Babangida joined the Nigerian Army at the tender age of 21 and was commissioned in 1962 as a second lieutenant. Perhaps no single Nigerian has influenced our national development like IBB. On August 27, 1985, Ibrahim Badamasi Babangida rose to power as head of state and later president and commander-in-chief of the armed forces of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. IBB married Miriam Babangida Nei Okogu in Kaduna in September 1969. They were blessed with four children, Aisha, Muhammad, Aminu, and Halimat Babangida. Accused by many, particularly the elite, and vilified by a few as a result of malignant manipulation of the press, IBB is loved by many more. Of all past and present leaders of the political and military class, IBB has made more friends across tribal lines, bridging the ethnic and religious divide. IBB is practically Nigeria's human bridge across the Niger. His achievement as president from 1985 to 1993 are the most remarkable by any administration since independence. Perhaps the singular sore point in his tenure as president was the unfortunate June 12, 1993 imbroglio. The June 12, 1993 elections, as well as all other elections conducted under IBB prior to that of June 12, 1993, were universally acclaimed as both free and fair. All the elections, from the ward elections to the local government elections, state assemblies, governorship polls to the National Assembly elections, were reputedly devoid of the gross malpractices that have characterized elections in Nigeria since the return to civil rule in 1999. The elections of 2003 were a disaster. The presidential elections of 2007 were worse. June 12 might have been an election without a president, but 2003 and 2007 brought forth presidents without an election. The respected Tafidan Katsina, General Shehu Musa Yar'Adua, once said that IBB had an instinctive feel of politics in Nigeria and appeared determined to put in place a structure that would succeed in creating a new order where the Muritala Obasanjo administration had failed. One manned by a new political class with a new motivation for its involvement in politics. Shehu Musa Yar'Adua, A Life of Service, a detailed biography and chronicle of the life and times of the revered Tafidan Katsina, and published by the Shehu Musa Yar'Adua Foundation, recorded and interpreted the events of June 12 thus. On June 10, 1993, Justice Mrs. Basi Ikpeme at the Abuja High Court ruled in favor of the Association of Better Nigeria, ABN, an organization headed by Arthur Nzeribe. Justice Ikpeme ordered NEC, the National Electoral Commission, not to conduct the polls. The following day, NEC Chairman Professor Humphrey Nwosu countered that Decree 13 of 1993 gave the court no power to make such an order.
For avoidance of any doubt, I wish to restate that the presidential elections scheduled for tomorrow, Saturday, 12th day of June 1993, will go on as planned.
On the 12th of June, the election took place in a calm atmosphere, but some linked the reported turnout of barely 33% of registered voters, less than in the state elections, to the legal uncertainty. On June 15th, with results from 19 states declared, the ABN returned to court to secure an injunction against NEC from releasing further results. The commission obeyed, although it challenged the court's interpretation of Decree 13, its injunction, and the charge of contempt for holding the election. There was obvious confusion in the nation, leading to a series of objections and support for or against the election. To further add to the confusion, there were a series of conflicting injunctions from courts of similar jurisdiction in Benin, Ibadan, Lagos, to name a few. More so, the political parties did not help matters. The National Republican Convention NROC hierarchy called for fresh elections. Bashir Tofa, the NROC candidate, believed there was clear evidence of rigging in his own state, Kano. In his own words, in these local governments where there are non-indigenous people, the SDP used a lot of money. A lot of money was put in, unquote. It was nearly 2 weeks before an uncharacteristically uncertain Babangida made a broadcast in which he announced formal annulment of the election. IBB went ahead to reiterate his government's commitment not only to hand over power, but also to leave office on August 27, 1993.